It's now my pleasure to introduce our special guest who will lead the Q&A discussion this evening and who will introduce our main speaker. Cheryl Blackman is the Interim General Manager, Economic Development and Culture with the City of Toronto. Prior to this role, she was Director of Museums and Heritage Services, where she was responsible for 10 city-owned and operated historical museums, the city's collection of historical objects, archaeological specimens, movable fine art, and an extensive portfolio of heritage buildings. Cheryl also served as the Assistant Vice President of Audience Development at the Royal Ontario Museum. Cheryl holds a Bachelor of Social Work and a Master's in Business Administration, and is a Fellow of Inclusion and Philanthropy from the Association of Fundraising Professionals. Locally, she is the past chair of the board, at the Robert McLaughlin Gallery here in Oshawa, and I've also worked with her for several years on the board of the Ontario Museum Association. So thank you, Cheryl, for joining us tonight, and I will turn it over to you to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Gretchen Sorin.
So, Alex, thanks so much for having me this evening. I am so thrilled to be here with you and all of the folks who are joining this Zoom call. It is my distinct honor to be able to introduce Dr. Gretchen Sorin. Dr. Sorin is a director and distinguished professor at the SUNY Oneonta Cooperstown Graduate Program. She holds a BA degree from Rutgers University in American Studies, an MA in Museum Studies from the Cooperstown Graduate Program, and a PhD from Albany University in History. Dr. Sorin has more than 30 years of experience as a museum consultant working with more than 250 museums. She has traveled extensively as an exhibition guest curator for many exhibitions, including the nationally acclaimed traveling exhibition, Bridges and Boundaries, African Americans and African Jews for the Jewish Museum in New York, and Wilderness Cure, Tuberculosis and the Adirondacks for the Adirondack Museum. Dr. Sorin writes and lectures frequently on African American history and museum practice. And if you want to hold up the book one more time, Alexander, the Driving While Black book is also available as an ebook, which is the way that I read it. So for those folks who like to use their Kindle, it's also available as a Kindle download. So please do pick it up. It is a fantastic read. And with that, I'd like to say good evening to Dr. Sorin and say how excited I am to be speaking with you this evening and turn it to you for your presentation.
Thanks, Cheryl. And thanks, Alex. I'm excited to be here. I love to travel to Canada with my family, and I thank you very much for the invitation. I'm going to start by sharing my screen and put some slides up. So I'm going to start by playing a very brief clip of some music. Oh, sorry. Let me find my cursor. There it is.
Oh, you know that every child
of God,
running for Jesus,
like an automobile.
Every child
of God,
running for
just
Jesus,
like an automobile.
Every child
of God,
running for Jesus,
just like an automobile.
So that was the Dixie Hummingbirds. They're a Philadelphia group. And that last line you heard, prayer was your driver's license, faith is your steering wheel. It is the Dixie Hummingbirds comparing the automobile to their Christian faith. And I am going to talk this evening about the reasons that the automobile was so important to African Americans. And as I've discovered, also important to Afro-Canadians. Now this is what you're looking at. If you've ever been to New York City, this is Times Square. This is the Times Square subway station. It almost never looks like this. This is during the days of the shutdown in New York. This is what the Times Square subway station looked like. And I think this story of limited mobility is something that we all got just a little bit of a taste of during the shutdowns, during this pandemic. So something just to keep in mind as we talk about mobility. Mobility was something that was restricted for African Americans as soon as they stepped onto the shores of the New World. Mobility was restricted for enslaved people. This is a paper pass, And this is what would be required if you were traveling as an enslaved person. You had to have a pass that would permit you to be out and away from your property, the property of your owner. This particular pass is from 1843, and it's signed by Mrs. James Madison, who was the wife of the President of the United States. And it was for Benjamin McDaniel, an enslaved man who was traveling from Montpelier, the Madison's home. Here you can see slave catchers. The very earliest police departments in the United States were established as slave catchers. These were the men and sometimes the women of the community who gathered in the evening with their lanterns and their horses, and they went out looking for slaves who were away from their property. And here you can see a slave catcher checking a pass for an enslaved person. They were out not only to make sure that Black people were on the property of their owners, but also to intimidate them and make sure they weren't gathering and perhaps planning insurrection. And here you can see two of the badges. This is the one on the left is the plantation police. And these badges for slave patrols look very much like the badges that we use today for law enforcement. Now, travel in the United States was segregated. This is an image of a segregated bus outside of a segregated colored waiting room. So for African Americans with segregated travel, it was unpleasant, it was humiliating. You had to sit in the back of the bus. But not only were you sitting in the back of the bus, but you had to endure the taunts of the driver and the other people on the bus who might be calling you names. You might have to stand if there were no seats available, even in the back. So it was humiliating, and especially African Americans didn't want their children to have to undergo this humiliation. And here you can see a segregated bus with African Americans sitting in the back. Now, trains were no better. Trains relegated African Americans to the colored car, and the colored car was crowded and it was dirty. It was rarely cleaned. The bathrooms were rarely cleaned. Compare that to this car, which is the white car. African Americans that traveled, I guess you would say, in a little better conditions were always the porters. And porters were generally Black, and they were both African-American and Afro-Canadian. And here you can see a porter. You often see Blacks in service because they were relegated to the most menial positions. The Great Migration, I think, is a very important event to talk about. It begins in the early years of the 20th century and really continues up until almost the 1970s. The Great Migration was the largest movement of people in the United States history. And it was moving Black Americans moving from the rural South to the urban North. And here you can see a family that has strapped all of their worldly possessions on their car, this particular one going to Cranberry, New Jersey. But the Great Migration, the automobile was one of the most important ways of traveling. And the reason was that you could get out of town by undercover of darkness. The bus stations and the train stations were often patrolled by men who were trying to keep their labor force intact. And they didn't want people to leave the South. And so if you had an uncle or a cousin or a friend who had an automobile, they could come down to the South and pick you up, and you tie all your possessions to the car, and that way you could escape. But not everyone found that the places that they went to were welcoming, and some went even further north. And this is a family, and you can see by the banners on their car, that left Oklahoma and they went to Alberta. Where they found discrimination as well. So even though they went to Canada, they thought Canada would be better, they found that there was discrimination there as well. African Americans were able to buy cars because they were moving into the middle class. Many African-Americans were moving into the middle class. And one of the reasons they were able to move into the middle class was that Henry Ford hired them to work in his plant in Detroit. And this is a slide of the Ford plant in Detroit, Michigan. And here you see Henry Ford III talking to some of the Black workers. Now, they made good wages. They still had to do the nastiest jobs, the most dangerous jobs, and the dirtiest jobs, but they made good wages and were able to move into the ranks of the middle class. And this is McKinley Thompson, who was the first Black designer at Ford, and he worked on the first generation of the Bronco. And this is a slide from 1956. And so by the 1950s, African-Americans were moving into the middle class and they were consuming automobiles, just as they were consuming percolators and ovens and refrigerators and all kinds of consumer goods. And they wanted to go out and see the country, to go to national parks, to go to museums. They wanted to visit relatives back in the South. So they wanted to travel, and they wanted to travel by car because it was the safest and it gave them the most liberty. And many families, like my parents, and that actually is that's a family photo, and you can see where my brother and I are standing behind the family Ford station wagon, and lots of families bought station wagons because you could carry lots of gear in your station wagon. So the automobile. African-Americans chose very specific cars when they traveled, and there were specific reasons that they chose those automobiles. And this is an Afro-Canadian. His name is Randolph Hope. He was in the Canadian Merchant Navy, and you can see he's got a big car. African-Americans chose big, heavy cars, not small cars. And the reason was that you had to carry a lot of gear. If you were traveling, you couldn't necessarily stop at a restaurant because they were segregated and they wouldn't serve you. You couldn't stop at a hotel because they were segregated and wouldn't serve you. So you might have to sleep in your car. That meant that Black people carried blankets and pillows with them. They carried lots of food, sometimes 2 days worth of food, or 3 days or four. So you would carry one of those big heavy coolers, metal coolers with you in your car. You might carry an extra gallon or two of gas because you didn't know if you'd be welcome at the local gas stations. So when you traveled, you really needed a large trunk and a comfortable car in the event that you and your family had to sleep in it and eat in it. So it becomes your rolling living room. The most popular car for African-Americans was the Buick. Buicks were heavy, they were luxurious, and they were large. And this is the Buick Electra. And I think it's apropos here because it says, all the Buick Electra Limited lacks is a fireplace. And here you can see a snapshot, a family snapshot, a family who's just pulled over by the side of the road to have their meal. Now, this is Medgar Evers, who was a field secretary for the NAACP. And Medgar chose a very specific car, and his car was the Oldsmobile Rocket 88. And he chose a Rocket 88 because it was a fast car. And he was going, his job required that he go to the site of cross burnings, the site of church burnings, the site of lynchings, and it was dangerous. He was going into small communities, into the backwoods, and it was very dangerous to make those trips. And a fast car would enable him to get out of the way very quickly if he was being chased by some people who didn't want him there. It was also a nice wide car, and Medgar was more than 6 feet tall. And he wrote that he could stretch out on the front seat of his Oldsmobile 88. And of course, Medgar Evers was shot in 1963 and murdered beside his car in the driveway of his home. Here you see the famous Chuck Berry with his beautiful, well-polished Cadillac. Now, you probably have heard the stereotype of Black people all driving Cadillacs. Actually, African Americans purchased Cadillacs in the same percentage that white people bought Cadillacs, about 3%. However, lots of entertainers like Chuck Berry, Sammy Davis Jr., Mahalia Jackson, they owned Cadillacs. They owned them because they could afford them, because they were entertainers and they made good money. And they owned them because they were comfortable and they were large and they spent a lot of time on the road. So the other reason that Cadillacs and large expensive cars were popular with African Americans was that Black neighborhoods were redlined. And if you lived in a redlined neighborhood, you couldn't get a mortgage. So even though you had disposable income, you couldn't buy a house. And so you put that disposable income into your second largest purchase, which would be your automobile. So that's why lots of African Americans could buy large expensive cars. And this is a 1930s Cadillac on a street in Harlem. Another reason for having a really fine car was so that you could go home in the summer and visit your family and show them that you had done well, that you had a good job, that you were doing well up north, that things were going well for you. This is a beautiful car. Although Alex tells me the museum wouldn't like it because there's just too much chrome to polish. I'd have to agree with that. So I'd like you to think for a moment about the intersection of race and space and think about what it must have been like to live before there were automobiles. So most people stayed put. I live in upstate New York, and just about every 10 miles, there's another little town. And every little town has its own Presbyterian church, its own Episcopal church, its own Baptist church, its own general store, its own post office. Excuse me. And the reason is that people didn't travel from one community to another. People generally stayed within 2 or 3 or 4 miles of home, and they stayed within their own little communities. So you needed each church within those little communities. The automobile changes that. The automobile makes it possible for people to crisscross the entire country, to go long distances, to go outside of their communities. But for African Americans, when they leave the spaces where they live, the spaces where they feel comfortable, the spaces where they know they're welcome, they don't know what they're going to find. They don't know if they will be welcomed, and that becomes a problem. One of the things you need when you have cars is highways. And during the 1950s, there's a massive building of highways across the country. Of course, when you build highways, you have to find places to put them. And many of the highways were put through traditionally Black communities. So although African Americans liked to stay on the highways because they felt it was safer, they felt they wouldn't run into small towns where they didn't know if they'd be welcome, the highway was a double-edged sword because it was often put through Black neighborhoods and destroyed those neighborhoods. It was also dangerous for African Americans to travel by automobile because of automobile accidents. Hospitals, as you see here, were segregated. If you got into a car accident, you had to call a Black ambulance. And if you got into an accident with a white driver, the white ambulance had to come in and take the white people away first before the Black people could be taken away to the Black hospital. But there were only 200 Black hospitals in the entire United States. And so if there was not a Black hospital close by and the white hospital wouldn't accept you, you might die as a result of an accident that could be survivable. So it was very dangerous as well for African Americans to go out on the road. It was also dangerous for other reasons. And here you can see some of the landscape of segregation in the United States. This is a sign in Alabama for welcoming people on the road to the Klan. Welcoming them to Klan country. And this is the banner across Main Street in Greenville, Texas. It says, Greenville, welcome, the blackest land, the whitest people. A very intimidating sign. And of course, all over the United States, there were hundreds and hundreds of sundown towns. A sundown town was a town that you could work in service, but you had to be out of town by six, by sundown, or there could be danger. And sundown towns often had signs like this. There were even some sundown towns that had sirens. And so a siren would go off at 6 o'clock, letting any Black people that were in the village or in the town know that they needed to get out. Towns like, these were all over the United States. Darien, Connecticut was a sundown town. Sheboygan, Wisconsin. Manitowoc, Wisconsin. There were hundreds of sundown towns in Ohio. So these were really dangerous places. And of course, if you were traveling, you didn't necessarily know what town was going to be a sundown town. You had to be, just had to be careful. And there were real threats. You could encounter an angry mob. You could encounter, as some drivers did, you could encounter the Klan. So you had to be careful. And in 1936, a New York publisher named Victor Green decided that he wanted to do something about it. He wanted to make it safer to go out on the road. And he created the Negro Motorist's Green Book in New York City, in Harlem. It was in business from 1936 to 1966. And it was a simple listing of hotels and motels, garages, service stations, places you could buy gas, places that you could eat, restaurants, but also places like beauty parlors and drugstores, places where you would feel comfortable and where they would welcome you as an African-American person. This is Victor Green and his wife, Alma. Victor dies in 1960 and Alma takes over and she becomes a woman-owned business, which was pretty unknown at this time to have a woman-owned publishing business. Victor Green's motto was travel is fatal to prejudice. And he really believed that if Black people could just go out and travel and meet white people, if white people could encounter Black people, that that would diffuse prejudice. And so his goal, and he writes this in the Green Book, his goal was to be put out of business. He hoped that someday the Green Book would not be needed. This is a copy of the cover of the 1948 edition of the Green Book. And you can see that he was marketing his guide to the Black middle class. You could see this light-skinned couple with their matched luggage, their suburban house in the background, and their automobile. This is the first generation of Black executives are being hired in corporations, and they are needing to travel for work, and they're using the Green Book. The Green Book was very polite in its messaging. It didn't talk directly about segregation. It said things like, carry your Green Book with you, you may need it. So it was really coded language, but the guide was there to help people as they traveled in a segregated world. But the Green Book wasn't the only guide there was. There were many kinds of guides, and you could see here a copy of Travel Guide from 1957. There was Traveler's Guide, there was the Bronze American. There were probably 100 different guidebooks that were available for African Americans. It shows how popular they were. But the Green Book was the most long-lasting of these travel guides. Probably the reason it was the most long-lasting was because of Victor Green's relationship with Standard Oil, which owned Esso, and is now, I think, Esso in Canada, but Exxon in the United States. And Victor Green made a deal, he had a contract with Standard Oil that they would market the Green Book, that they would give it out or sell it at their gas stations. But most importantly, that Esso gas stations would not segregate their bathrooms, that they would allow African-Americans to use their gas, their bathrooms. And therefore African-Americans flocked to Esso gas stations. It was a very smart business decision. So when Black people were traveling in the Green Book guide and in the other guides, there were listings of all kinds of different places for them to stay. Places like this one, which was a guest house in Oak Bluffs on Martha's Vineyard. There were motels like this one in Hot Springs, Arkansas, the South's finest Negro court. You could just hop right off the road and pull right up to your door, and then in the morning get back on the road to go to your destination. But there were also luxury hotels like this one, the Hotel Teresa, which is in New York City. It's actually still standing. It's no longer a hotel, but the building is still standing in Harlem. And then many of the places listed in the Green Book were like this. They were private homes. They were guest houses. And many women across the country saw this as a way to make extra money. And they would open up their homes if they had an extra bedroom or two extra bedrooms. And they would open up their homes and provide a breakfast and sometimes a dinner. So it was really an early form of a bed and breakfast. But there were, starting in 1948, there were a variety of places listed in Canada, including the Royal York Hotel, which is still standing in Toronto. And this one, which is the Hotel Casabella, which is in Montreal. I'm sure that both of these hotels were integrated. They were not just Negro hotels. They were hotels that welcomed African Americans, but that were also open to everyone. This is an interesting article that appeared in the Baltimore Afro-American in 1952, and it's called Motoring Through Canada. And it is the most, it's a really happy article encouraging African-Americans to go to Canada because they'll have a wonderful experience. And it talks about the various places that they recommend visiting. There's a friendly 1500 mile Canadian vacation free from Jim Crow planned for the United States motorist seeking a foreign vacation this year. The starting point is Niagara Falls, Ontario. So one would think that going to Canada would always be a much better experience than traveling in the United States. However, if you look at this article from the Philadelphia Tribune in 1939, it says Canada court, okay, Jim Crow against Negro. So this is a story of someone who attempted to go to a tavern and was not served in Ottawa. And the court, the Canadian court, upheld the right of the tavern keeper to deny service to the African-American and his friends. And this one, Canada Jim Crow's race lawyer says, excuse me, is another story about Jim Crow in Canada. So visiting Canada was a mixed bag. There were some places where African-Americans were welcome and could feel comfortable. And there were other places where American Jim Crow was the rule. But I'd like to talk for a few minutes about the automobile and civil rights. And I would argue that the civil rights movement in the United States in the 1950s and 60s was totally dependent on the automobile. It could not have happened without the automobile. When the men and women that went south to work for civil rights arrived, they needed places to stay. They needed places to eat. And the places that were in the Green Book, the hotels, the motels, the restaurants, were the places that they stayed. They were the places that they ate. And this put the owners of these businesses in great peril. It was very dangerous to identify with civil rights workers and to help them. And yet these people chose to do this because they felt it was the right thing to do. This is an image of the A.G. Gaston Motel in Birmingham, Alabama, right after it was bombed. and it was bombed because this was the place that Martin Luther King used to stay when he was in Birmingham. So it was at, it was putting your business at risk when you went south. But if you think about registering voters and the importance of doing that, this is the called the Jenkins microbus. It's an object that's at the Smithsonian now. It's a Volkswagen, obviously, Volkswagen bus. And it was used to travel throughout a county in Georgia to register voters, to bring vaccines, to bring education, to bring literacy education to people in the community. If you think about it, you could not register voters or bring any of these things, healthcare, literacy, to voters without a car, without a vehicle. You couldn't do it on foot. You couldn't do it with a bus. So it was really important for the people that were doing this work to have vehicles. And here you can see a car that was being used again to register voters. But the automobile was particularly important for boycotts. In the Montgomery bus boycott, and here you can see Martin Luther King assisting some women in getting into a car. The key to the boycott was to keep people off of the buses, off of the segregated buses. The goal of the boycott was to desegregate the buses. And the only way to do that was to limit their ridership so that the buses would hurt, so that the buses would be deprived of their revenue. And the way that they did this was by marshaling private vehicles, private automobiles, and driving people to work so that they wouldn't lose their jobs. They also purchased this fleet of automobiles, and they used these automobiles to drive people to work. They would drive along the bus routes and pick people up and take them to their jobs and take them home. And they were able to cut the revenue of the bus company by 69%. And this was done in the Montgomery bus boycott and in boycotts in Florida and in other states as well. And it was the way they used to basically break the back of segregated busing. But the other thing that was really important about the automobile was the rental car industry. If you were African-American and you flew into a city in the South, there was no way for you to get from the airport to your Black hotel. And the reason was that the Black cabs were not allowed to pick up people at the airports. Only the white cabs were allowed to pick up people at the airports. And so you would be just stuck at the airport. The rental car made a big difference because you could then fly into the airport, rent a car, and then it would take you to your hotel. So rental cars, this was a new industry, and it made a huge difference in the civil rights movement. At the same time that marches were going on, there were attempts to break open the hotels, places like Howard Johnson's and Hilton Hotel that were segregated. And in 1964, the 1964 Civil Rights Act opened up all public accommodations to all people for the first time. When Howard Johnson's was opened and Hilton were opened, African Americans started to go to these places because they could. What this did was it decreased the number of people who were going to Black-owned businesses that had supported, that were listed in the Green Book. We think there are probably only about 5% of the sites in the Green Book remaining because most of them went out of business. And that's the irony of this kind of sad situation. But I'd like you to think about where we are today. We started off with thinking about mobility and the role that mobility plays in a free society. And then we have Ahmaud Aubrey, who was running in a neighborhood and white men perceived that he shouldn't be there and they murdered him. This is Philando Castile, who was murdered in his car by police officers. So his obviously his freedom was restricted. His freedom was taken away. His civil rights were taken away by police. And we saw in the very beginning, we talked about the role that police played in restricting the mobility of African-Americans. This is the June 22nd, 2020 cover of The New Yorker, which shows all of the African-Americans who have had their freedom of mobility restricted, taken away in the United States from the very beginning. And ending, of course, with more recently, George Floyd. And so Black parents often have a talk with their kids, especially their boys, about what to do when the police stop you, how to act, how not to move, how to obey all lawful orders, how to be courteous. And of course, this cartoon says, avoid being Black. This is Kenrick McCray. Ken McCray is a Montrealer, and he drives a Mercedes. He has been stopped dozens and dozens of times in Montreal because he is a Black man driving a Mercedes. And in his hands, you see a camcorder. He's decided that he's going to start recording his interactions with police officers because he's been stopped so many times. And this is also in Montreal, a sign addressing the issue of racism in Canada. This, Black Lives Matter, there are actually five chapters of Black Lives Matter in Canada, in the largest cities. So this is not a scene from the United States. So this is my final slide. I think, and I'd be happy to entertain your questions and your discussion, but I think we need to, some of the racism that's experienced by African-Americans in the United States is also experienced by Afro-Canadians. Even though there are things about Canada that I think African-Americans have found very delightful. The integrated hotels, for example, in the 1950s. The special opportunities they had as entertainers in Montreal and in Toronto in the 50s and 60s. But I think it's also something that it's not perfect. And there's a lot of work to do in both of our cultures. So thank you very much. And
so Dr. Sorin,
questions.
Dr. Sorin, thank you so much for that presentation. Absolutely fantastic. I have quite a few questions that are coming out of your presentation, and I'm going to kind of get the audience warmed up so that we can certainly talk a little bit more deeply with them about what their questions are as well. At the beginning of your presentation, that audio clip that you shared, every child of God running like an automobile, prayer is your driver's license, faith is your steering wheel. That just hit me right in my heart. You know, it's clear to me when I heard that audio clip that there are a lot of significance around the car as your protection, mm-hmm. you know, as your shield. So can you talk a little bit about what the planning was like for a Black family, an African-American family who wanted to travel? What kind of a planning regime would they put in place just to be able to take that car that they've purchased out, and how would they even begin to plan to purchase that vehicle considering all the challenges?
They were so anxious to buy cars that they would, if you couldn't buy a car at your local dealership, if your dealer wouldn't sell you a car, you would go to a white friend and get them to buy a car for you, or you would buy a used car. So I think that there were enough people that were willing to sell cars to African-Americans. They didn't have a problem buying cars. Excuse me. And driving was something that was accepted for African-American men to do in particular, right? They could be truck drivers. They could be chauffeurs driving in service. They could be delivery men. That was an acceptable employment opportunity for Black men, driving. Now, the whole idea of driving a fancy car, a fancy Buick or a fancy Cadillac. That was not acceptable for, you know, some people felt, well, a Black person shouldn't have a better car than me. You know, I'm driving a little Ford and they're driving a fancy Buick. That's not okay. And that was especially true in the South. So after you bought your car, if you were going on vacation, you planned. And that's one of the things that Victor Green talks about in the Green Book. He says, plan, plan, plan. Get out your maps, know exactly where you're going, know where you're going to stay each night. Don't leave it to chance. Don't just go out on the road and expect that you're going to be able to find a place to stay. Plan it out. And people would write letters and say, I'm going to Kittery, Maine, or I'm going to be coming through Detroit. And they would write letters to these hotels to get reservations and have their entire itinerary completely planned out, leaving nothing to chance.
So I love that you talk about planning your entire itinerary. My husband thinks that I'm really anal and that I overdo the planning, and I can see now that it's in my DNA. It's not just an accident. But what is a particular automotive brand or company? You mentioned Ford, that is recognized as a trailblazer for marketing their vehicles to Black motorists. My father had a Chrysler. He had a very big Chrysler growing up, and that was the car that took us everywhere. What are some of those brands?
You don't see any marketing to Black people until the 1970s. So before the 1970s, there's no marketing, but the first company is Ford and then GM. GM is right on the heels of Ford, and they also start hiring African-Americans to work in the GM factories. So I would say those are the two that are out ahead. And you said your father was driving a Chrysler?
A Chrysler, yeah.
GM product.
Yeah.
It's not a GM product. What is
Dodge? Chrysler Dodge.
Chrysler Dodge.
Yeah. But he always drove a big car. And, you know, there was only two of us as kids growing up. And I thought to myself, why do we have this big car? But when you put it all in context, it makes so much sense. So, you know, also in the book, you talk about the fears that African-Americans had and how those, you know, and clearly, you know, in your slide presentation, those fears are relevant to the current day. But what's the correlation between that fear and the automobile in particular in terms of how the automobile would have been kind of like a liberator?
So the idea of having your own car, really, you felt that you protected your children, right? That your children didn't have to hear these taunts. They didn't have to get called the N-word on the bus, right? So getting on the bus or the train was kind of frightening because people would say terrible things. So that made you feel, putting them in the back seat, they were safer, they were protected. But at the same time, if you had to have that plan so that you knew exactly where you were going, what the route was, and staying on the highway was important because you're not going through any little back roads, you're not getting lost. There's a story in the book about a young boy whose uncle is taking him to a funeral, and the family's in the car, and they get lost in Texas, and they get off the highway, and they're lost. They don't know. They're somewhere near Waco, and they encounter a man who is actually, it's basically a lynching. They're driving past, and they're, what's going on? Oh, somebody's, the town is getting together to burn somebody. And then when they see them, they go after them as well. And so, you know, it was dangerous. It could be dangerous to get off the highway. So you wanted to make sure that you stayed where there were lots of people and lots of light.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in the US, you folks call it AAA, we call it CAA here, that Automobile yeah. Association, you know, and certainly, you know, we used to use those triptychs, you know, and plan our trips like meticulously so that we had every single move kind of thought out and we knew exactly where we were going. So what was the role of AAA? Was it supporting Black motorists in the period that your book is written about, or was there another type of organization other than the Green Book that was really kind of beginning to recognize the Black motorist as a customer?
So it's really interesting that you asked that because I didn't know a lot about AAA until this summer, and AAA asked me to give a talk for them. And what I discovered was that AAA was really racist. And they did not allow Black people to be members of the American Automobile Association in the beginning. And they wanted me to talk because they wanted to think about what they need to do now, today, to address their historic racism. So African Americans, if you were stuck on the road, you were stuck on the road. And unless you were in a Black neighborhood, you were in trouble. I talked to Lonnie Bunch, who is at the Smithsonian. He's the secretary of the Smithsonian. And he's an old friend of mine, and he's also from New Jersey. And he recounted the story of his family, of his father. They got stuck on the road, and the police showed up immediately, and they weren't interested in helping them. They just wanted them out of, you're in the wrong neighborhood. You're in the white neighborhood. Get out of the neighborhood. And they said, well, our car doesn't start. And he said it was the most afraid he's ever been in his life. He was a kid, 9 years old, I think. So there was no interest in helping them. The interest was in getting them out of the Black neighborhood.
And so it's interesting because you talk very much about the opportunity for there to be travel and for there to be fun as a new experience for African Americans. And so when people are trying to drive to experience leisure, do you know if there was any correlation between air travel and the way that folks were being treated in the air versus on the ground? Was there any distinction between air, rail? What was happening there?
The difference in air travel is that airports are operated by federal government and not by states. And so air travel was not supposed to be segregated because it's operated by the federal government, as it is in Canada, right? Because you can't have a state operating the airlines. The problem is that airports were operated by states and were owned by states, and they had concessions in them. You know, so if someone owns a sandwich shop in an airport, they might segregate it, and they did. Or a couple of the airports, I think in Texas, they didn't bother to put a restroom for African-Americans in it at all. No restroom. And there was another airport someplace, and I can't remember what it was, where they put no restrooms in the airport because that way they didn't have to deal with the issue of segregation. They're just, nobody gets to go to the bathroom. So, which is a ridiculous solution. But airports were not supposed to be segregated, and neither were flights. However, there was a lawsuit in New York for American Airlines because they were putting little marks on the tickets to indicate who was Black so that the stewardess would put those people together and not have them sit next to whites. So that was a lawsuit. The airline lost, and they were told not to do that anymore. There was a story that I was told by Rachel Robinson, Jackie Robinson's wife, that when they were flying to, they were flying the first time to, spring training. They were going to spring training. They were going from California to Florida for spring training. And I don't know was it the Dodgers? I don't know baseball. I should. Dodgers? Branch Rickey put them on a plane. And before they got on the plane, Mrs. Robinson, that's Jackie's mother, showed up at the airport. Now picture Rachel Robinson's got on an ermine coat, this white ermine coat, all dressed up to go to spring training. And Mrs. Robinson, Jackie's mother, shows up with a shoebox full of fried chicken, and Rachel Robinson doesn't want to insult her, so she takes this box of fried chicken. They get on the plane, they fly the first leg to Texas, they get off the plane, Texas won't let them get back on another plane to Florida. And so here they are, they're stuck in Texas. They have to go make their way in a Black cab to the Black neighborhood, find a Black hotel. They have nothing to eat. Oh, they have a shoebox full of fried chicken. So that was what they had for dinner. And the next day, Branch Rickey sent a car to take them from Texas to Florida. But there were instances of problems with airlines but generally airlines were not supposed to be segregated.
So I wonder to myself, and this is a follow-up to the earlier conversation, that piece that you kind of shared with us regarding the purchase of a used car, and understanding that that car also did not have a cell phone, you know, because it's way before cell phones. So were there ham radio operators? How did folks communicate when they were on the road? And how did that actual purchase happen if there was so many barriers for African-Americans?
I don't think they communicated while they were on the road. I think they listened to the radio. I don't think they communicated. I mean, there were pay phones. Remember those? Phone booths and pay phones. But I don't think there was any other way. People wrote letters to reserve hotel rooms and to reserve resorts. They wrote letters. And postcards. So, and what was the rest of that question?
Just regarding the purchase of that used car, what that transaction, how would folks go about finding that white family that was willing to sell to them, a Black family, African-American family, that car? How would they make those connections safely? Well,
you might be buying it from another Black family. And very often Black people bought a lot of new cars from dealerships, and they were often white dealers. Money talks. And one of the things that I found in the research was that the part of the reason that Victor Green thought travel was fatal to prejudice was that as African-Americans traveled, people said, oh, these people have money. They have disposable income. We want it. Therefore, in order to get that money, you know, we're going to be more accepting of people, you know, except for the really hardcore racists. But there were people that felt this is a market. We can, you know, we can exploit this market and get money. And that's certainly what Esso did. Esso gasoline was so smart in that they said, you know, the Black middle class is a growing market, and we would like a piece of that market. And so we're gonna let these people use our bathrooms, and we're gonna sell them gas, and they will buy our gas because we're not segregating. And that's what happened.
So throughout the book, the notions of mobility, space, and freedom, they're intertwined. Mm-hmm. You know, and you certainly speak about the ideas that lean into the American principle of liberty and life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And in Canada, every year on April the 17th, we celebrate the anniversary of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. And that was actually only signed in 1982, which is just a mere 40 years ago. With Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday having just passed on January 15th, and then Mr. Sidney Poitier's recent passing at 94 years old, just in the last week, you know, has that liberty and the pursuit of happiness dream been realized?
To some extent for some people, you know, I think the Black middle class has expanded dramatically. I think we have started to see a lot of young people who are more open. There are certainly a lot more biracial people. And I think we, you know, people have so many friends who are, you see people that have relationships with, but I think for the United States, it's almost like it's mostly in the big cities and on the coasts. You know, it's on the California coast, it's on the East Coast and the West Coast. I don't know how much of it has reached smaller towns and communities in the middle.
Yeah, and so in the chat, in fact, I was looking at some of the questions there, and there's some really interesting questions/comments about sundown towns and just the idea that some folks are also moving from the US to Canada, even in current day, to find the respite in Canada. And you mentioned it in your presentation that, you know, there are pluses and minuses in every place for people from the African diaspora. So, you know, I wonder to myself when I was reading the book, because driving is something I've been doing since I was 16. I've always loved the feeling of the road, and I always make sure that my cars are close to the road so I can feel the road, you know? So once winter solstice happens and every minute we get one more minute of sunshine, I'm getting that excitement, that itch, that feeling that I'm going to be able to actually live up to Ontario's license plate motto, Ontario, yours to discover. So how did the automobile become indispensable for African-American families seeking upward mobility?
Well, I think a lot of that has to do with the your inability to buy a house. You know, you're looking for, what am I going to do with this disposable income? And one of the things to do is to travel, to see the country, but also to see the world. And there were a lot of newspaper articles and magazine articles that encouraged people to get out of the United States and go to places, go to Canada, go to the Caribbean, go to Europe, go to Africa, to visit places, go to France, places where African Americans might be perceived in a different way. That article that I showed, that I think that I'll send to the Automobile Museum, because they could probably, it would probably be a useful article, really extols the virtues of a trip. And it suggests starting in Niagara Falls and going all the way to Quebec City and then to the Maritimes, which I thought was fascinating. And it says, this is gonna be the best trip you've ever taken. It's gonna, you know, and it there's not a hint of racial discussion in the article. It's just, this is gonna be the best trip you've ever taken. And these are the places along the way to stop. These are the places that you should go. And I found that really fascinating, especially since it was in the Baltimore Afro-American newspaper. Obviously somebody made that trip and it was a great trip and they wanted to encourage other African-Americans to make it as well.
So I'm wondering here, this is one of the questions in the chat, and this is an interesting one, about the way that increased mobility of African-Americans led to desegregation and progress and the sense of progress that came at the expense of Black-owned businesses. You know, because clearly when you're in a segregated community, you are really going to your neighbor to take care of your needs. And once you desegregate the community, how that impacts Black-owned businesses. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, you know, that's the real sad aspect of this story, because there was really a separate world. You know, every Black neighborhood, every Black community. I talk a little bit about Fayetteville, North Carolina, which is the home of my mother. You know, there was an enormous Black community. There were restaurants and coffee shops and all kinds of Black-owned businesses, and they go out of business. You know, they all go out of business. So, you know, it's really unfortunate, but I also understand why people decided they wanted to go to Hilton or go to, I mean, even though, you know, it's a cookie cutter room, they're all the same no matter where you go. I understand, because they had worked so hard through the courts. You know, this is kind of the parallel movement of the civil rights. They're going, the NAACP is going through the courts to break open public accommodations. And they've worked so hard to get into these hotels. They want to stay in them.
You know, it's interesting, Dr. Sorin, because to this day, for me, quality is number one. And again, we kind of disconnect ourselves from the history and the struggle, quite frankly, by virtue of how comfortable we are today. You know, so if we go back in time and we go back to Victor Green's Green Book and the motto, which I absolutely love, which is travel is fatal to prejudice. You know, and really kind of considering that book was established in 1936 and published annually until 1967, which is just a little under 55 years ago. And it listed guest homes and hotels and motels and restaurants. And Canada had its first kind of presence in that guide in 1949. And by the time the guide was concluded in 1967, there was just under 50 locations in Canada that were listed in the Green Book. So locations in Montreal, in Quebec City, Ottawa, Niagara Falls, Hamilton, Windsor, Regina, Brantford, Cornwall, London, 12 locations in Toronto, and you mentioned, you know, the King Eddie, Moose Jaw, yes, Sault Ste. Marie. So we know there was definitely a presence there. But the idea that the hints for driving while Black, they don't end at the border. Those right. hints are still applicable when you cross the border. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, you know, Canada, it's a separate country, but in many ways that we share some of those same negative things, the prejudices that, you know, that are part of the United States, that are part of being white, are still there. Those stereotypes about what Black people are all about. And, you know, I don't know much about the history of law enforcement in Canada, but I did talk with a Canadian policeman in Montreal. But he was actually very quite open about how he does his training and what police are required to do in Canada. And yet, you know, policemen don't eliminate their prejudices just because they're police. You know, the stereotype of who commits crimes and who is a dangerous person, those are still with you, whether you're an individual private citizen or a policeman, a law enforcement person. And I think clearly Black people are still facing those same stereotypes and are disproportionately stopped by police in Canada as they are in the United States. And that's obvious from the newspaper accounts.
Yeah, absolutely. So there are obviously trends in ownership of automobiles. And the trends in the early kind of 50s were grounded in Ford and GM, as you mentioned. But what are some of those, do you know some of those specific trends for car ownership today? And are they still correlated to the idea of safety related to the fears of driving while Black?
One of the things that I found that's very interesting in talking to people is that some of these things have become family tradition. So even though they may not any longer, like your dad may not any longer need that giant sized car, but it may be part of the tradition to buy it. And I was talking to a woman recently, and she said, you know, we still go on vacation at night. We leave at night. We leave when it's dark. And I said, why? And she said, it's just family tradition. You know, so I think some of these things have become a part of culture, even though they're no longer necessary.
Absolutely. I mean, when we're driving to the US, it's at night we leave and we want to get there right. We say to ourselves, we want to get there bright and early to start and really enjoy the fullness of our time. But really, I think it has more to do with the traditions of needing to be out on the road in a way that makes you feel safe and comfortable so that you can get to where you're going in the light of day and feel safe and comfortable where you're going. So absolutely. And in your talk earlier, you spoke about, you know, the African-American male driver. When does the African-American female driver become somebody who is really out there? And could the African-American male or female driver, could they actually count on white community support or assistance in their travels? And how would they know who the safe people to speak to are?
They wouldn't. I don't think you would know who was safe. That was the reason for these guidebooks. But there were also newspaper articles. There were magazine articles that were, you know, specific about, very, you know, go to this place or here's a route to take. You know, the article in the Afro-American about the trip to Canada was very specific. You know, it said, start here, then go here, then go here. So there were lots of newspaper articles and magazine articles that kind of laid out an itinerary for you so you would know what was safe and what was not safe. And I think people followed those.
It's kind of like a coded language that helped folks to understand what to do in some ways, it sounds like, Dr. Sorin.
Yes, and there were columns. There were regular columns in the newspapers of, I took a trip here and here's how I did it. You know, so it was really kind of a how-to guide for people going on vacation. And of course, you were generally going from a safe Black space to a safe Black space. So you might be going to Martha's Vineyard. Well, every year you went back to the same place. You weren't necessarily, you know, you weren't roaming around looking at the, the landscape. You were going specifically to the same place every year. And, you know, maybe it was Martha's Vineyard, or maybe it was American Beach, or maybe it was, you know, one of the places in Toronto, wherever it was, you were kind of sticking to the same route. One person was telling me that every year they went to Florida, and every year they stayed in exactly the same places and went to exactly the same restaurants, or stopped at along the same rest stops to eat their food. You know, it wasn't like you weren't experimenting and driving off the road and, you know, taking the scenic routes.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's funny because today, you know, we take a lot of things for granted. It's the privilege of being in a, you know, modern world right now that we take a lot for granted. And we pick up the phone, whether it's our landline, for those who still have those, I still do, and our cell phones, and we call 911, and somebody will invariably roll up at our door in a quick time. And we don't think about the fact that that person might be denying us service because of the color of our skin. So, you know, in your book, you talk about just needing to get help and what that looks like and the concerns that come with that. So when you call 911, you know, what would actually happen if you were an African American and you needed help, and what kind of experience would that be?
So first they would ask if the people involved were Black or white. That was rule number one: are they Black or are they white? And then there were separate ambulances. And sometimes the Black ambulance was also, this was the most horrifying thing, the Black ambulance was also the hearse. And if the hearse was in use as a hearse, they couldn't come. They wouldn't be able to come until they had finished with what the funeral was. So, and then they would put you in the hearse. So it was very dangerous to get in a car accident. If you think about 200 hospitals spread across the United States, I don't know how many hospitals we have now or how many are in Canada, but if you think about the number of hospitals that we have now and compare that to just 200 Black hospitals, it's pretty frightening. And of those Black hospitals, many of them were not even accredited. They were, and many of them did not have trauma centers. So if you got into an accident anywhere near a hospital like that, you could be done for if it was a serious accident. And there were also examples. I talked to a couple of men who actually worked in a funeral home, who were also ambulance drivers. And they told me that sometimes people would say, well, and this is in Mississippi, they'd say, well, can you drive us to Chicago from Mississippi? So they knew that there was a good Black hospital in Chicago. And if you weren't terribly badly injured, let's say you had a broken limb or something, they wanted to go to Chicago. They would have to pay for you to drive them to Chicago.
It's incredible. And I think, you know, when we think about, you know, just the ways that Black enterprise was created and then also fell apart through this period of time, you know, folks don't realize that there was a Black Wall Street.
Right.
And, you know, can you talk a little bit about how the automobile and upward mobility would have helped to create a Black Wall Street?
Yeah. And, you know, there were lots of businesses all over the United States that were related to the automobile and that were related to Black tourism. And there were resort communities. There was a resort community in Michigan. There was one in Florida. There was one in LA. You know, all of these resort communities are gone, but there were summer resorts that African Americans went to every year. And of course, the one that's still in existence is in Martha's Vineyard. But, you know, I think we're not even aware of these places.
Yeah, I think, you know, it's amazing to think about that, for sure. I am wondering to myself, you know, about you spoke earlier about karting in Canada,
right?
Which is very similar to stop and frisk.
Stop and frisk, yeah.
You know, and this is a decade for people of African descent. Many people still don't know, even though the decade is more than half over. And so the United Nations Working Group of Experts on People of African Descent, they were visiting Canada back in October of 2016. And when they were here, they actually did a press release, and that press release contained some pretty strong words about the realities of the African-American or the African-Canadian experience in Canada. And so they said, you know, carding or street checks disproportionately affects people of African descent. They went on to say that, you know, that they were particularly concerned about the overrepresentation of African Canadians in the criminal justice system. And there is, you know, this real kind of sense that with progress, there are still a lot of things that, as folks would say, there are still many rivers to cross. Can you talk a little bit about some of those rivers and what that crossing looks like and the connection to the automobile?
You know, I think for us in the United States, the worst part is being stopped, is police officers stopping Black drivers, Black motorists, for menial things, a broken taillight, an air freshener hanging from the rearview mirror. And some of these traffic stops have resulted in people being shot. One of the things that I've been very concerned about is the inability of policemen to defuse situations rather than escalate situations. And this is something that I did talk with my Canadian friend, police chief, about how do we train law enforcement to defuse situations instead of making them worse, right? So when you go into a situation where that's very volatile, how do you make it calm down rather than explode and end up with somebody dead or with somebody beaten because, you know, things have gotten out of hand? And I think that's one of the huge problems with the automobile in the United States. I wonder why we decided, and the Canadians decided, that law enforcement, well, that driving, that traffic safety was something that should be controlled by the police. It doesn't have to be, right? It could be controlled by a public safety officer of some kind who could just handle things like running a red light, you know, things that really related to public safety. And that would leave law enforcement to handle the things that law enforcement needs to do. Bank robbery, you know, really serious crimes. Law enforcement, as opposed to, you know, traffic safety. They're really two different things. And if you drive now in the United States, especially in New York where I live, there are no more toll booths, right? They've eliminated all the toll booths, all the toll takers. It's all done electronically. So you have Easy Pass and you drive and it automatically bills you for the toll. So why can't it do that for speeding, for running a red light? I mean, those things can be done electronically. They do not have to be somebody stopping you who is terrified of you because you're a person of color, and they're ready to shoot you because you're a person of color, right? Yeah. The research has shown that traffic stops are not netting the police any criminals. They're very, very few. They're getting an occasional joint or a little tiny bit of marijuana, but they're not netting them real criminals. So the criminals are elsewhere, not in traffic stops. But traffic stops are the low-hanging fruit, right? You'd rather stop a car for a broken taillight than go after a crazy, you know, lunatic with a gun.
Yeah, you know, it's amazing how much knowledge is held within your book. And it's amazing how much knowledge is held within this talk just this evening as well. And so one of the questions that's come through is, you know, about the importance of education and curriculum and the importance of telling the story that, and you know, at the Toronto History Museums, we talk about telling hashtag tell the full story, you know, telling the full story. And this idea that, you know, the history of enslavement, the history of discrimination and racism, all of these histories, we really need to be able to understand the full story. So how do you feel about, you know, curriculum including these important stories? Because I know for myself, I would love to see Canadian schools teach more deeply this kind of content as just a matter of course through the curriculum. What's happening on the US side?
Actually, this book is being used in a high school in Seattle. It's being used in my local high school. It's being used in a high school in New Jersey, which surprised me. I was not thinking of it as a read for high school students, more for college students. But I really think it's useful for people to talk about mobility and the freedom of mobility, and to think about it, because actually it's not in the US Constitution at all. It was in the Articles of Confederation, but never made it into the Constitution because it was just assumed. It was assumed that of course you have the freedom of mobility. So we don't think about it, but if you've looked at any of the newspapers and the related to COVID, you see that everybody is really up in arms when their mobility is restricted. And they're angry about their mobility being restricted. So it's obviously very important.
Well, it's so important, in fact, that in the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, one of the rights is mobility rights. So we have, you know, 7 entrenched categories in the Canadian Charter. The first one is fundamental freedom. The second is democratic rights. The third is mobility rights. The fourth is legal rights. The fifth is equality rights. The sixth is official language rights. And the seventh is minority language educational rights.
Know these well.
I had to put them here to memorize. I couldn't memorize them because I'd forget them. But I just know that during a crunch, you don't want to forget these important things. But you want to remind everybody on this call tonight, this webinar tonight, that, you know, these are some of the differences between Canada and US. But again, that these are new rights. 40 years is a very new set of rights. And quite frankly, to your point, Dr. Sorin, about the pandemic, we've seen how the pandemic has eroded rights. So, you know, because ultimately there has been so many concerns about personal freedoms, as well as concerns about, you know, just, you know, what are people's rights to do X, Y, and Z. But we are in a war state right now, and rightfully so, because it's a pandemic. But that during those moments, there are erosions of rights and freedoms. And those rights and freedoms, they do come back once the period is resolved, but the reality is those rights and freedoms do get affected by pandemics. And that's just the reality of the world we live in. And this is not the first time that's happened in history. So, you know, so at what point in history were African Americans allowed to be police in cars? Was there a actual specific era when African Americans were finally kind of able to transition into spaces where they were working with white officers side by side, and that driving while Black didn't so much keep them as out of these types of law enforcement jobs that they were previously subjected to, is kind of the question that's being asked.
So when do Black policemen, you know, one of the things that's been rather interesting is that there are some Black policemen that have kind of, they believe in this blue wall and that have adopted some of the same behaviors. What the research shows is that the people most likely to stop African-Americans, to disproportionately stop African-Americans, are white men. The second group likely to stop African-Americans are Black men. The third group, and it drops off considerably, the traffic stops, are white women and then Black women. So who are the least likely to disproportionately stop African Americans. So you do find that men in general are much more likely to stop African Americans And Black men are only a little more likely, a little less likely than white men. You're muted, Cheryl.
I just realized that. Thank you so much. It's amazing how time has flown by here. We are actually at 8:24. And so I just want to point out to the folks on the call tonight that I have been weaving their questions through our conversation so that it kind of came together feeling seamless, but hopefully I didn't miss anybody's question. And if I did, please let us know through the chat and we will certainly work on getting you those answers. But Dr. Sorin, I just have to say thank you so much for such a robust conversation and for an awesome opportunity to meet and speak with you for the first time in this way. I'm really honored to have had this opportunity tonight. So I'll turn it back to Alex.
Well, thank you so much, Cheryl and Dr. Sorin. Both of you have been so generous with your time this evening. We still have a record number of people actually on the call. I know some people dropped off, towards the end, but we still have a lot of people who have finished the talk with us after an hour and a half. So thank you all for joining us. Dr. Sorin, do you have any final words or anything else that's come to mind that you want to share?
No, it's just fascinating to look at Canada and to think about, I hadn't really done a lot, but to look at Canada to think about the similarities and the differences, it's been wonderful. So great. Thank you for that.